So, good morning, everybody. Stefan Schwarzer is a Pythonist for 15 years. He has written articles and a book on Python. Also, he's a regular speaker at Linux and Python conferences. And also, he maintains the FTP util library, which is quite handy. Thank you. today, he's going to discuss problems and best practices for maintaining code for Python 2 and 3. It's going to be about like a 35 minutes talk, and we have 5 minutes for Q&A afterwards. So please welcome Stefan.
Okay. Thank you very much. Wonderful. Good morning. Okay. Yeah, I want to give this talk about supporting Python 2 and 3 with the same code. Maybe for the introduction, something about me. Okay, some things were already mentioned, but I have a degree in chemical engineering, but in 2000 I kind of switched sides. I mean, I'd been programming since I was 15 before, and in 2000 I became a full-time software developer. Since 2005 I'm self-employed. I maintain all this FTP util client library, and the starting point for this talk was that I was myself in the situation when users asked for Python 3 support and FTP util. There was one ticket, and then at some point there was a question on the mailing list, but I had shied away a bit from this, so I went through. Okay. Yeah, last year we had this, I had this FTP util 3.0 release with Python 3 in addition to 2.6 and 2.7. Python 2 or Python 3, I think most in the audience will actually have read this. This is from the Python website. When you go to the download section, there's a link, Python 2 or Python 3, and this is the wiki page you get when you click on that link. So it says Python 2 is legacy. It doesn't really say you shouldn't use Python 2 anymore, but it's strongly in the direction. Python 3 is the present future of the language. Okay, so is Python 2 obsolete? So in a way it is, yes. On the other hand, it isn't, because it's still very widely used. There's lots and lots of legacy code. Python 2 is also the pre-installer, the version when you say yum install Python or aptitude install Python, you get Python 2, or it's even pre-installed, usually on Ubuntu and also Fedora and Red Hat. And Python 3 is optional. Red Hat Enterprise Linux is only yet getting there. They have a Python 3 package now, but also, if you want to host, if you buy hosting and don't do the hosting yourself, there are more hosting offers available for Python 2, I think. And many libraries don't have a Python 3 version yet. And I guess that's a reason why some of you are here, because you want to change that. Okay, so my recommendation is use Python 3 if you can. And one thing I find very important is also if you migrate or adapt your library, you ease the transition for others who say, okay, I still need your library to migrate myself or adapt myself, my software for Python 3. Okay, there are different approaches. The first one, in the beginning when Python 3 came out, the recommendation from the Python development team was use 2.2.3, write Python 2 code, convert this to 2.2.3 with this command line tool. Then later there was some 3.2.2 tool. I think it's rarely used, but the idea is that that Python 3 code is usually looks a bit cleaner, and it's nicer to be able to maintain Python 3 code than to maintain Python 2 code. Okay, but what it seems the Python world ended up doing, or mostly doing, is developing or having the same code for Python 2 and 3, so you don't have to run 2.2.3 neither the user needs to run this nor do you during development if you want to test in Python for Python 2 and 3. So it's just always the same source code. Okay. One major problem. There are many things. If you look at what's new in Python 3.0, there's lots of stuff. But I think the most important thing when it comes to this adaption of the code for Python 3 is this bytes versus Unicode topic. And so I want to say maybe refresh something on this. Okay, we have in both Python 2 and 3, we have bytes, or bytes type, or byte strings. I think the Python 2 terminology is mostly byte strings, and in Python 3, usually when you read documentation, it says bytes, it's not really byte strings, so because the intention is you don't use it for strings, or not for character data, or only for encoded character data. Okay, so these are the kind of raw bytes that you store on a disk or send over a socket when you need to make a decision. Now, I have Unicode, but it needs to go somewhere and I need to encode it. On the other hand, Unicode text represents character data where characters have number code points. But this is unrelated to how the characters are stored. So it's not just another character encoding like Latin 1 or so, or some code page, I don't know, the characters are numbered, these code points, and at this point it's unrelated to how this is later represented in bytes. Okay, so this Unicode text can be encoded to bytes. You can choose an encoding. Of course, the encoding should support the characters you have in your string, in your Unicode string. So if you have, for example, Chinese characters, you can't convert this, encode this to Latin 1. Okay, and this is at the bottom of the page. This is just one example. These would be the Unicode code points for this German word hören, to hear. And this is the bytes if you encode this Unicode string to UTF-8. So this one byte becomes these two bytes, otherwise it's unchanged, but this depends completely on the decoding, on the encoding you apply. Something that might be confusing while you are working on this adaption for Python 3 is that both Python 2 and 3 call their default string type. So if you write a byte literal in Python 3, this is the byte string type, the binary type here, and in Python 3, it's actually the Unicode style type, the text type. You also have the byte string type is named bytes in Python 3, and Unicode is the Unicode type in Python 2. Okay. One major change, and this is again one of the difficulties for Python 3 support often, is that in Python 2 you can add a byte string and a Unicode string with this prefix. And mostly it works unless this byte string contains anything non-ASCII. Then you get a Unicode decode error dependent on the process data. So one day you run the code and it runs fine, and the other day you read a text file which has an umlaut or something or some special character, and you get an exception. And Python 3 this has changed, and you don't have these implicit conversions anymore. Get a type error every time you want to add a byte string and a Unicode string, which I think mostly is a good thing, but it's makes it this migration harder, this adaption for Python 3. In Python 3, you have to be explicit, and for example, if you have a byte string which has this B prefix, you need to decode it explicitly, then this becomes a Unicode string, and this is in Python 3. This is a Python Unicode literal as well. But in actual code, you shouldn't usually do it like this. But I will talk about this later. Okay. Also in Python 3, which I find a thing that I find logical that makes sense is that everything or almost everything which took strings or byte strings in Python 2 now requires Unicode strings. So in Python 3, this is again by default, this is a Unicode string. This works, but if you pass the constructor of decimal a byte string, it complains and gives you a type error. There's also a new file API in Python 3. In Python 2, if you open a text file, it still gives you byte strings. Yeah, if you open a text file for reading, it always gives you byte strings. Whereas in Python 3, it gives you Unicode strings, really. Yeah? In Python 2, it just does, whether you choose text or binary, only changes the line ending conversions. And there's also no more file objects. The return value of open depends on the arguments of the open call. The good thing for this migration, for this adaption for Python 3, is that this open function, which is the built-in open in Python 3, is also available in the I/O module in Python 2.6 and 2.7. You know, one thing that tripped me up in another small tool is that standard in and standard out and argument values here, this is argv, are Unicode strings. Stdin read gives you Unicode strings and write requires a Unicode argument. But you can work around by using buffer, the buffer attributes, which give you the file object, which works with the raw bytes, with the binary data. Okay, steps. Yeah, so now the first part was introduction. Now, but how you actually do this migration or some tips or steps here. You should have automated unit tests, if possible unit tests. I liked this keynote from Emily Bach on, I think, Tuesday, where she also mentioned approval testing. Yeah, which so if you don't have unit tests, but I recommend you have them. If you don't have unit tests, so you should at least have some automated tests that you can run on your code. The unit test should pass 100% under Python 2, and since you are just starting out supporting Python 3, you can't expect that that they work on Python 3. Lots of these tests will fail if you just do the experiment and you have unit tests for a Python 2 version and you run the same test with Python 3. You probably get lots of failures and errors. Yeah. That's completely normal. Sometimes I notice that, for example, in FTP util, that most of these failures come from string literals in the test code, in the unit tests. Another thing is that sometimes you only need to change a few functions, do the conversions in your code, and maybe even then lots of your tests pass again, even under Python 3. You can also do this test or try running even the Python 2 version with the option -3. This is supported in Python, I think from Python 2.6 up. Will give you some information, will print some warnings or information on things that need to change for Python 3. Yeah, while you are changing your code to adapt to Python 3, make sure you have to change the actual code, the production code, and the tests, and keep them in sync. And so you don't have if you can, not that many failed tests. Okay, one tip. I found this nice tool. I can imagine many of you know this already. This is Tox. Nice tool because you can easily run Python 2 and 3. The test both on Python 2 and 3. And Yeah, so you can check if they still work on Python 2 and if they already work or to which extent they work for Python 3. I also like that it implicitly checks whether the packaging works for your library or for your code. Okay, since we are going to support Python 2 and 3 with the same code, you run, I mean, 2 to 3 is still useful, but I recommend running it once. So for example, print became a function and some the exception syntax changed in Python 3 or the required exception syntax. And 2 to 3 does many of these straightforward conversions. So in this way, it's nice. You should have a look at the documentation on for 2 to 3 on the about the fixers. There's also these are different steps, this different conversions that can be applied. So it's not just everything or nothing, but you can individually turn on certain conversions. You should exclude the future fixer because this removes all from future import statements. What you don't want, you want to keep the from future imports in for your Python 2 code. Many of the changes will be you don't want to keep them literally. I mean, the print conversions you probably want to keep as they are, and some changes, for example. Changed module names, for example, config parser in Python 2, which was spelled with a capital C and capital P, is now all lowercase in Python 3. So 2 to 3, it expects that that Python 3 is your final target destination. It removes, it just changes the import to all lowercase config parser. But if you look at the changes that 2 to 3 did, you see, you do a diff with a version control system, and you see what it changes. And so, for example, you see the changed import statement, and you need to take care of this. Have different code or a switch or something later for Python 3. Really check all the changes. Someone I talked with, I think yesterday or so, mentioned or suggested running the fixers individually. So with each diff, you see the changes only from this fixer. Of course, this requires that you know all the fixers. I mean, you can get this information, but you have to make sure or should make sure that you don't forget any of them. Okay, and after you ran 2 to 3 and made your changes, everything at this point should run again under Python 2. Okay, and if you're lucky, you already have an API that that you can keep for Python 3 or doesn't make you jump through hoops if you want to support Python 2 and 3. I was not so lucky with FTP util, so I had I would say I had to change APIs to support Python 2 and 3. So the new FTP util 3 is not backwards compatible with FTP util 2.8, which was the previous version. And the standard library in Python 2, almost everything that accepts a string accepts either Unicode or bytes. And in Python 3, with rare exceptions, you have to use Unicode for strings. And my suggestion, therefore, is use Unicode for text data. If you have to, if you want to decide on, you should decide on Unicode for text data and not keep the bytes interface that you may have for Python 2. And you need to know or even define what data is text data. Sometimes corner cases where you really have to think or maybe even define whether something is supposed to be bytes or Unicode. One recommendation is encode and decode text at system boundaries. So everywhere, this example is reading a file from the file system, decode it, And later, if you, for example, you want to send this over a socket to some other host, you encode this, but only then. Yeah, so you should try to have most of your code deal with Unicode strings. So if you, yeah, I mean, as far as strings are concerned, I mean, of course, the other types are not affected. Yeah, so if you look at code, so you don't have to think, in Python 2, this will do that thing. On this case, I will have byte strings. And when I run this on Python 3, these strings will, I think they will be Unicode strings or something like that. Yeah, so you should avoid this. You should try to, if you have strings in your code, try to get to the point that, you can confidently say that or know the locations where it's Unicode and where it is not. Yeah. Okay. Sometimes it can get a bit hard. For example, in FTP util, maybe I should show something. This is code you can write with FTP util. It's mostly sitting on top of encapsulates FTP lib, FTP, but it's more high level. You can write, the intention is that you can write code as if you were using the OS module or shutil module, OS path. You can use walk and listdir on these host objects. You support the with statement is supported. You can use isfile, and you have these convenience methods like download, for example. And you can also open remote files, and read from remote files, for example, or write to remote files. Okay, and for, since the, one difficulty with FTP util was that I don't only have to convert between bytes and Unicodes for file contents, for the remote files, but the harder part was dealing with the encoding of file names or directory names when I sent them over a socket. And I also checked a bit, these are some sections. So what you see on the next slide is this upper right corner, and on the slide after that you see this part. So for example, I made this diagram and attached nodes and how these interfaces behave on both Python 2 and 3 to wrap my mind around this and get this straight, how I should deal with this. This is the other part where I'm using ftplib, how does ftplib handle this in Python 2 and Python 3? Where are the conversions? Because the string arguments for files that ftplib uses are, it also requires Unicode. And so I was wondering how do they encode this, or how do they know the encoding or something, when I want to finally send this to the FTP server, this file name. So it really depends on your project how complicated that is. Sometimes maybe it's straightforward, then you are kind of lucky. I mean, you are even more lucky if you can keep your API and only make internal changes. But especially if you need to change the API, if you can't come up with a clean API that is expected by the user, or that a user can easily work with in Python 2 and 3, then you need to think harder. Okay, and that's really the part that can't be automated. Some more tips. Don't let functions or methods accept both Unicode or byte strings. So something like, if I get a byte string, I convert this to Unicode, or if I get a Unicode string, I convert this to a byte string or something, because this makes the API confusing, and you always have to think about, is this now, or under which conditions, is this a byte string or Unicode string? And it also makes the tests more complicated, because you always have to check both. This have to check both for Unicode and byte strings for the arguments. And imagine you have something that takes two or three strings and you want to test all combinations maybe even. Yeah? So you should try to avoid this. Yeah, special case file-like objects or strings for paths, because in both in Python 2 and 3 you can use all these APIs that accept file names or directory names with either byte strings or Unicode strings, and it will, yeah, under the hood will call different APIs on the operating system. So, and this also gave me some headaches with ftpUtil because I do this as well. And so in this case, I have to accept both Unicode or bytes and do different things because I try to mimic these APIs from, for example, the OS module. Okay, if you, but if you don't accept the strings, but let accept file-like objects, so this is handled before, so it's not part of your library anymore. So if you can get away with this, yeah, you probably should use file-like objects or instead of accepting file name strings. I mean, you can, of course, still have this for user convenience, but this makes it a bit harder. So, also avoid different APIs for Python 2 and 3. For example, for ftpUtil, I was thinking at some point for backwards compatibility, when you run on Python 3 and I open a text file for reading, it should give you, as before, to be backwards compatible, give you byte strings, and Python 3 give you Unicode strings, because you expect this under Python 3. But this would really be a mess. Yeah, I made up my mind and wrote summaries on the advantages and disadvantages and posted this to Complang Python. What do you think? How should I deal with this? And I got two answers, both saying explicitly go for the unified API, even if it breaks backwards compatibility. Okay, and I think this was a very good decision to make. Also make a list of changes before actually changing the API, because this will hopefully make sure that you don't forget a change, that you still maybe need to change different parts of your code and don't want to forget something. And it also helps you write some release notes. For example, for ftpUtil, I wrote what's new in ftpUtil 3.0. So I could check this list and make sure I don't forget anything. You could also use commit messages, but commit messages are usually more fine-grained and are maybe not so useful for this purpose. Yeah, and another tip. If you need to change the API, increase the major version number, the first part, and I mean, it's, after all, adding Python 3 support is a major change, and so you can get away with the API changes. Yeah, so I think it's justified. I mean, it's not just a trick, but I think it's fine. Okay, some other tips in general on this Python 3 adaption. Read what's new in Python 3.0. At least I actually recommend you also, I mean, not instead, but also read this porting to Python 3. I have links at the end of the slides and I will put the slides online. But even if you just search on the net for porting to Python 3, you will probably get this website. This is practically an online book, which is really nice. If possible, support only Python 2.6 and up. Because Python 2 and Python 2.6 and Python 2.7 have some very useful Python 3 features backported. For example, you can say from future import print function, and you will have print as a function with the same behavior as in Python 3. Also, the exception syntax, so starting from Python 2.6, you can write except exception class as exception object. You can't do this in Python 2.5, and if you need the exception object for exception handling and want to support Python 2.5 and lower versions, it gets really messy and it's not really nice. It isn't fun, I guess. Also, Python 2.6 and 2.7 have this I/O module, so you can say if you want to from IO import open, and then you have the open, the built, yeah, like the built-in open function from Python 3, but have it available in Python 2. If you need to support Python 2.5, you can use the 6 library. In summary, anything below 2.6 will probably be awkward to support. There will still be some things that need to be different for Python 2 and 3. And I recommend, I'm not the only person recommending this. I saw on the net to use a compat module, for example, for Python, for ftputil. It looks like this. You just say if Python 2, if the Python version is Python 2, by the way, use this indexing if you want to run your code on Python 2.6. Because in Python 2.7, this is a name tuple and you can write .major, but this doesn't work on Python 2.6. Okay, and here I have int types, a tuple of int types, Unicode type, bytes type. Now this is much easier than reading the code and trying to remember, reiterate, I'm now on Python 2 and the str I'm seeing here is the bytes type or something. This is error prone. Okay. If you have a larger project, also have a look at the future or 6 libraries. I think the future library looks a bit more modern. It's actually newer than the 6 library. For ftputil, I decided to not use it because ftputil doesn't have any dependencies apart from the standard library, and I didn't want to introduce a dependency just for these few things you saw in my compat.py. Okay, and for every Python file, that's at least what I suggest. These are some changes which make your Python 2 code behave more like Python 3 code. For example, the absolute imports are required. The float division, or the integer division rather, has changed from Python 2 to 3. And for example, if you use from future import division, you get this Python 3 behavior for integer division. I already mentioned the print function. Unicode literals will, when you do from future import Unicode literals, all the literal strings in your code will, even under Python 2, will become Unicode strings, Unicode string literals. Alternatively, you can use, alternative to Unicode literals in Python 3.3 and up is the U prefix. This was removed in Python 3.0, but was reintroduced in 3.3. But you still have to know what string type your literals are, and it's maybe a matter of taste whether you generally use Unicode literals with the import or if you use the U prefix explicitly. Okay, then summary. So Python 2 is still in wider use, but I recommend using or developing for Python 3 if you can. Using the same source code to support Python 2 and 3 is feasible, makes sense. Also larger projects are doing this. Django, for example, have gone this way and have the same source code for Python 2 and 3. You need to know the concepts of Unicode bytes and encodings, and the changes from Python 2 to 3. So again, read what's new in Python 3.0 and porting to Python 3. You should have tests for adapting to Python 3. Otherwise, it's much more difficult. You should at least have some tests, even if you have kind of acceptance tests or these approval tests that Emily mentioned. You should prefer APIs in Python 3 style, write modern Python, plan and implement necessary API changes carefully. As you would design, if you designed your API for your library from scratch, maybe even, do what makes sense for Python 2 and 3. I already mentioned reading what's new in Python 3.0, and yeah, if you can actually require at least Python 2.6, because this will give you several of these future imports, and if you want to support Python 2.5, for example, yeah, you have to write some convoluted code maybe. Yeah, okay, that's all.
Thank you very much, Stefan Schwarzer. So if you have a question, please raise your hand and I will come by with a microphone.
Well, this is half question, half remark. I have a project where I also maintain both Python 2 and 3 at the same time with the same code base. But I noticed that while it is feasible and cool to be able to do that, you give something up. So you give some of the features in Python 3 up. So for instance, I spent a long time struggling to find out if there's an equivalent in Python 3 of the admittedly weird construction in Python 2 where we can re-raise, so you catch an exception and you want to raise another exception with the same trace back as the original one, and you don't like to raise exception, comma.
This additional trace back addition in Python 3, yeah. I think
can you go to the microphone? Because I can't hear.
Okay. In Python 3, yeah, what you probably mean is you already have this these chained exceptions. And in Python 2, I think you can use an additional comma separated argument for to give a traceback object or something. But I fear in the end you have to do it kind of manually and setting these extra attributes. Yeah. That's also one thing I thought about. Yeah.
Yeah. Is this on? Thank you for the talk. It was really interesting tips. But what about porting C extensions? C extensions, like for Python.
Okay, this is more complicated.
Sorry. Okay. I haven't migrated or adapted any C extensions so far. So I can't. From what I heard, changing C extensions is much more complicated.
It is, but there is a document that ships with Python. I think it's in the how-tos directory that gives you guidance on porting C extensions from Python 2 to Python 3.
Mm-hmm. Okay, any more questions? I think, let me check. This last question.
Thank you for the talk. I think right now you're one of the most competent persons for that topic in the world.
Thanks.
If you would reconvert your FTP util library again, starting from scratch with all the knowledge you have now, what do you measure it would take in by means of percentage to do it again?
With my knowledge now, I can really. Maybe a week or maybe less. I really don't know. I mean, this was stretched out over several weeks because this is a free time project.
Yeah, you had to find all these things out. You gave
okay.
This nice presentation.
Okay. I have this habit reading a lot of stuff before I start. Yeah. So mm-hmm. So I did some research before. For example, this compat module is also mentioned by Armin Rohrnacher in some blog post or something, this recommendation. But I think it makes sense anyway.
So if I would say it takes several percentages if you just mechanically apply all these patterns
Okay. Some of the kind of mechanical changes can be done by 2 to 3. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this at least helps. I find it very useful to run 2 to 3. Not only because it. I mean, you should read what's new in Python 3, but running 2 to 3 on your code will also give you some insights or maybe some things you forgot when you read the what's new document. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it will see change some things, and you might wonder, what did it change there? Is this something? Obviously, this seems to be something different in Python 3 in comparison to Python 2.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks a lot, Stefan.